What are the biggest pros and cons, the good and bad, of European river cruising? I'm Gary Bembridge. This is another of my cruising tips for travelers. I want to take another look at European river cruising, and I want to talk about the five biggest pros, the good things about it, and the five biggest cons, perhaps the downsides of river cruising. So let's start by taking a look at the positives, the pros. Probably one of the biggest pros of European river cruising is the amount of choice. There is enormous amount of choice. So first of all, you have a choice of rivers. There are loads and loads of rivers, pretty much any of the major rivers within continental Europe you can cruise on. So you can cruise on the Rhine, the Rhone, the Danube, the Loire, the Seine, the Elbe, the Douro, just goes on and on and on. And some cruise lines will give you the choice of cruising on pretty much any of those rivers. The second great thing is you have an enormous amount of choice in cruise lines. So certainly offhand, I could think of at least 14 or 15 cruise lines, and there are many, many more that I've seen on the rivers that I just can't remember. So you have names like Arosa, Amur Waterways, Amadeus, Avalon, Crystal, Carossi Europe, Phoenix Reisen, Nico, KD Cruises, Scenic, APT, Viking, Tauk, and just many, many more. What's really important with that is you have a lot of choice. So you have value lines at the one end. So you might have lines like Riviera or Carossi Europe, which are more value for money, right through to really plush and expensive and 5-6 star cruise lines on the rivers like Crystal or Uniworld. So you have a huge amount of choice. You also have a lot of choice in terms of the type of experience that you want. So you'll find some will create a very multilingual European experience like across Europe. Some will even be more German focused or Swiss focused. You'll some find that some are even more targeting the UK travelers like Riviera or Fred Olsen or Saga. They all offer cruises which are very UK traveler focused. And then some have a more American feel to them. So Amur Waterways, Avalon, those kind of lines. And then you'll find some even have a slightly more even Australian twinge to them, like APT, Scenic, maybe even Emerald. So you'll certainly find there's a huge amount of choice of rivers, of different cruise lines, and of types of experience. So choice is definitely a big pro. You're going to find hopefully a river cruise line and a river that meets what you're looking for. I think the second biggest pro is it's a pretty immersive and in-depth way of seeing a region. So if you're cruising along the Danube, for example, you're going to get to go through a number of different countries. You're going to be going through lots of beautiful scenery. You're going to be seeing lots of big towns. You're going to be seeing lots of little towns, and you're going to get really, really close to the culture. I think what's great about a river cruise is, first of all, you normally will go to some big iconic town. So again, using the example of the Danube, you're probably going to go to things like Bratislava, Budapest, Vienna. On the Rhine, you're going to go through big major cities as well. So you're going to go and see the big iconic cities. You're also probably going to go and see, therefore, some of the big iconic and famous sites. But also, because of the nature of the river and cruising through, you're also going to stop at very out-of-the-way little villages or perhaps places that were really big in the medieval times and they have a historic castle there. Or you're going to stop because there's some significant agricultural winemaking or some chateaus. So you definitely get a huge cross-section of big iconic, big bustling towns down to sleepy little villages. So it's a very immersive way of seeing a particular part of the world. Also, what the cruise lines try to do to make it more immersive is you'll find they cater the onboard experience to give you a more immersive experience. So you'll find that the food, for example, on European river cruise, as you cruise the different countries, will serve traditional dishes. They'll also have wine from that particular country. They'll also bring on board perhaps dancers or singers, musicians or speakers to give you more of an immersion into the culture and the history of that particular region. So it's quite an immersive experience. So I really like that you see a part of the world in a pretty in-depth way. That for me is a big pro. Another big pro is, unlike ocean cruising where often you have the fare and then you have lots and lots and lots and lots of add-ons, what's great about European river cruising is pretty much all of the cruise lines on the European rivers have largely all-inclusive fares. So there's very little or very few extras that you're going to have once you're on the ship. The key inclusions normally are, of course, your accommodation, all your dining is included. Also, your excursions are included. So depending on the cruise line, you'll either get one set excursion every place you stop, or sometimes you'll have a choice of those. Some of them might be more active, some of them might be more cultural. And you will normally then have, of course, all your onboard entertainment. Wi-Fi is normally included. And most cruise lines will include some drinks. So it might be just drinks with lunch and dinner. Some will include all of your drinks all of the time. So very all-inclusive fares. The extras that you have, some cruise lines will have gratuities. Obviously, they're optional as extras. Some will include it. Drinks, depending on whether they've included all the time or not. And depending on the cruise line and where you book transfers, so flights obviously into Europe and getting to and from the ship. Now, many cruise lines will, depending on what you're buying, will sell the whole package. Some of those you have to buy the cruise and then work with your agent or yourself to build the various packages, pre-stays, post-stays, transfers, that kind of thing. That tends to be extra because obviously you're probably going to tailor that more. So the fares are largely inclusive. I found when I've been on river cruising, I have had bills of almost nothing, and perhaps there's been some cash I've given for gratuities. The great thing is the fare, you're not gonna have lots and lots of extras. Another great pro is river cruising is incredibly hassle-free. It's even more so, I think, more hassle-free, less stress-free than ocean cruising. On a river cruise, everything is pretty much decided for you. Once you've booked the cruise and the destination, you have to worry about nothing because you arrive, you unpack, of course, it becomes your sailing hotel, you then pack at the end. But everything's decided for you, so your meals are all set for you, your excursions are set for you, all your briefings are set for you, your transportation, everything's arranged for you. You literally decide the itinerary, decide where you want to go, and you pitch up, and you have to make very, very few decisions. So it's very hassle-free. It's a great, easy way of traveling through Europe. So if you wanted to go through three or four countries, which some of these river cruisers do, if you were having to get on trains or planes, there's a lot of downtime, a lot of hassle, a lot of stress. All of that's gone because it's really, really quite a curated, and you're kind of shepherded and looked after, and all the decision making is done for you. So that's definitely a big plus. I think it's a very hassle-free, easy, simple way of seeing Europe. Another really great plus, a pro, is the fact that it's a much smaller, intimate experience. Obviously, if you go on an ocean cruise ship, you could have up to thousands of guests, or even if you go on some of the smaller, you're gonna have a couple of hundred guests. River cruise ships in Europe are probably going to be between about 150 to 200 guests. So it's quite a small experience. Also, it means that you're going to get to know the crew very well. You're going to find you have 30 or 40 crew on those ships. So you also get to know the crew incredibly well. So it's a much more intimate, much more, it's easy to meet people. You get to know everybody on the ship. And so it's definitely a very different experience. Of course, if you want to be anonymous, you're probably not going to find that on a river cruise because everyone's going to get to know you. Those for me are the big pros, the big pluses of river cruising. So what are the downsides? What are the cons of river cruising? Probably one of the cons of river cruising in Europe is just how popular it's becoming. So as I already mentioned, there are lots and lots of river cruise lines and more people are coming onto the rivers all the time. So the places are getting more and more busy because obviously there's only a certain amount of rivers. They all tend to go to the same places because that's what people want to see. So you start to find that some ports and some itineraries are getting really busy. So you may find, for example, that when you dock in a place, you have ships either side of you and you have to go through or over ships to get there. Out in the places, particularly some of the smaller places, you can find it gets really busy because you've got lots of tour parties, excursions, heading out from all the different river cruise boats there. So it's almost a victim of its own success. It's getting really, really busy. And I think one of the things that river cruising is starting to do is to find ways of alleviating that. So you're gonna find there's more and more excursions which take you further afield. There's more active excursions, things like bicycles, heading off on bicycles and stuff like that to try and disperse people much more. But I think that's one of the probably downsides, it's getting really, really busy. The second possible con for some people is the ships are small and you're not gonna have lots of choice. So if you're used to ocean cruising, you're used to lots of choice of dining venues, gyms, big production shows, lots going on. That's not the case on a river cruise ship. They have to be a certain size and a certain height to be able to navigate the rivers. So you'll find on a typical European river cruise boat, you're going to have one dining room, which is where you're going to have all of your meals. A few do have a second dining option, but generally speaking, it's one dining room. You're going to have one lounge and bar where you have your briefings, drinks, all that kind of stuff. Up on the sun deck, you might have, depending on the ship, you might just have places to sit. Some of them might have a little crazy golf course, or they might have a plunge pool. Some of them will have a small fitness center or a massage room, but it's very, very small. So you don't have loads and loads of options. You don't have lots of shops, that kind of stuff. So certainly if you're the person who likes lots of choice, lots of options, then river cruising is probably a downside for you. You do, of course, within those ships have everything you need. You've got place to eat, you've got a place to relax, you've got a place to sun yourself. So there is although there's not lots of choice, you do have all of the key things that you need. Also, because the ships have to be a certain size, you'll find, generally speaking, the cabins are relatively small and will normally only have a shower room and a pretty small shower room at that. So the cabins do tend to be a little bit on the smaller side just because they have to be. Another possible con of European river cruising, particularly if you're the sort of traveler that likes to be incredibly independent and do your own thing, is the whole river cruising process is relatively regimented. So I see it a lot similar to perhaps going on an escorted tour, because it has a lot of the same attributes to it. So you'll find the day is pretty laid out with relatively few options. Of course, you can just decide not to do some things, but bear in mind you will have already paid for those things. So you'll find you'll normally have some sort of announcement getting up, because breakfast is at a certain time. You'll then head off on your different excursions, so you might have to be back at a certain time because the ship's moving a little bit further along the river to the next port. On the excursions, you'll find they're pretty curated. They're normally walking tours. There might be, as I said, some active tours. You'll come back, you'll have lunch at the same time. There'll be kind of a set time to have your meal. You then might have a briefing or whatever. You'll head off on another excursion, you might be sailing. You'll then have the daily briefing for the next day where you're told what's going to happen, the various options. You'll have dinner, which you have at a set time. Again, not necessarily with lots of choices of other places to eat. And every day on a European river cruise is relatively set, curated, and there's not necessarily lots of opportunity to flex that. Of course, you could skip some excursions, go and explore yourself. On the plus side, a lot of the times you'll find you're perhaps docked overnight, so you can then head out into towns. But it is a relatively regimented set day and a set way of doing things because of the nature of European river cruising. So if you're a very independent traveler and you like to do things more on a whim, you might see that as more of a con. On the plus side, of course, it does mean that everything's organized, everything's sorted, and you do, and they do make sure that you make the most of your day on the river and in the places you call on. The next possible con depends a little bit on the type of traveler you are. I would say river cruising at the moment in Europe mostly caters for couples, and it does tend to be a little bit on the older side, so 50s, 60s, 70s, and even older than that, is really still the core of the traveler on European river cruising. If you're a solo traveler, for example, you'll find that it's a pretty expensive way of traveling because you normally are going to have to pay for double occupancy of a cabin. What a lot of cruise lines do, particularly in the shoulder seasons, is they might do some solo traveler deals, but you won't find lots of solo cabins and things like that. Also, if you are a person of limited mobility, river cruising in Europe is also a challenge, not only because the ships don't always have all the facilities, but the places you call on are not great. So some of the ships will have, for example, an elevator between the floors. Not all of them will have it. They won't always have accessible cabins. Some will have them. But the big challenge is, particularly if the ships are docked next to each other, moving through the ships could be a potential challenge. But also just the nature of the places you call on are very old. You have cobbled streets, you have steep banks, that kind of thing. So it's not ideal. If you want to go river cruising with your family, it's still kind of mixed. More and more cruise lines are trying to attract more families. So, for example, AMA Waterways have got more interconnecting doors. They've launched AMA Magna, which is a bigger ship. Some of the cruise lines are trying to, at school holiday time, build in more stuff for kids, to try and attract more multi-generational. But really, at its heart, it's still very much a couple's experience. And I've been on quite a few river cruises as a solo traveler, and of course you get to meet people, and of course you're very welcome. But it is an expensive way of cruising unless you can find those particular deals. Another possible con of river cruising is water levels. So if you're on ocean cruising, of course, you could have weather, wind particular could be the thing that disrupts you getting in and out of port swells, that kind of stuff. In Europe, it is water levels, so the water being too high or too low. And it can go through various times of the year where you have a real problem. So for example, a couple of years ago in Europe, there wasn't a lot of rain. It was almost a drought situation, so the rivers got very low. And that meant that the ships were very restricted. So for example, I was on a Danube cruise and we could only get as far as Vienna because the water was just too low off that. In other years, the water's too high and they can't get under the bridges. So of course, you need to be flexible and understand that you may have that as a potential downside. The same as if you go ocean cruising, you can't predict whether you're going to have swells or winds or whatever and miss ports for that reason. But do bear in mind, water levels is quite a hot topic and could be an issue within European river cruising. On the plus side, or the good side of that, is sometimes the distance you travel are not that huge. So what the lines will either do is they'll either bus you to a place, because you might find it's only an hour's drive away to get to that particular excursion, bring you back to the ship. Or what they've even done in some cases is they've moved people from one ship up to another ship further along the river and then carried on. River cruising in Europe is a great experience. It's a great immersive way of seeing a region. Like everything, there's pros and there's cons. And for some people, some of those cons are pros and vice versa. I hope you found that interesting. I have loads more videos about European river cruising, ocean cruising. So why don't you watch another one of those right now?